This year's May Day holiday witnessed a staggering number of visitors at major tourist spots across China. From Dunhuang, where camels trod paths reminiscent of the Silk Road era, to crowds under the bridges in Chongqing, almost resembling pebbles. The density of tourists was palpable. In Shanghai, the bund was less about the river view and more about the swarm of people. The Forbidden City in Beijing seemed like a maze of people, where navigating became a skillful task. Xihu in Hangzhou saw swimmers outnumbering the fish, and the scene at Nanjing's Confucius Temple resembled a competition of crowds. Mount Tai was obscured by the throngs, while the vibrancy of Xi'an's Da Tang Everbright City was overshadowed by the sheer number of visitors. In Changsha, maneuvering through the crowd, Wuyi Square, required dexterity. Climbing the Great Wall felt akin to ascending a human ladder. Mount Ermei hosted more people than monkeys, and a three-hour wait at Shanghai Disneyland afforded a mere five-second glimpse of Mickey Mouse.
During this year's five-day May Day holiday, the streets of popular tourist cities including Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, Shenzhen, Chengdu, Chongqing, and Changsha were bustling with people. Despite the heavy crowds, many visitors did not engage in shopping, resulting in numerous restaurants experiencing high foot traffic but low customer turnout. Observers noted four unusual phenomena in China's consumer market during the May Day holiday. First, there was a high number of travelers, but low per capita spending. On May 6th, China's Ministry of Culture and Tourism released data showing that during the holiday ending on May 5th, the total number of domestic tourists reached 295 million, a 28% increase over the same period in 2019 before the pandemic. However, holiday tourism revenue was 166.9 billion yuan. During the same holiday in 2019, the average spending by domestic tourists was 645 yuan. This year, it dropped by 565.7 yuan, a decrease of 11.5%. This year's May Day holiday tourism saw daily average spending of 113 yuan per person, also lower than the 151 yuan from the same period in 2019, setting a new low since last year's National Day holiday. Secondly, there was a trend of budget travel to smaller cities. Traditionally, Chinese tourists would travel to major cities like Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, and Chengdu during the May Day holiday. This year, more people chose to visit third and fourth tier cities like Tianshui and Gansu and Shuzhou in Jiangsu being popular choices. Data from Trip.com showed that during the May Day holiday, the growth rate of travel bookings in third and fourth tier cities outpaced those in first and second tier cities, even more so than county level markets. On the first day of the holiday, hotels in county level areas saw a 64% increase in bookings, and ticket sales increased by more than 200%. Many young Chinese said they chose to travel to smaller towns because spending was less and the value for money was greater. For young people, compared to first and second tier tourist hotspots where accommodation and dinings are costly, many smaller towns offer unique cultural attractions and sites at lower costs. Some people also opt for short distance road trips to save money. Thirdly, restaurants offering good value for money were popular among the youth. This year, there was a shift in consumer preference for dining, with low-end eateries and specialty restaurants becoming new favorites among young people. Social media platforms were abuzz with posts about the popularity of dining in smaller towns. For example, in the county-level city of Yanji, many social media users shared their experiences of local dining hotspots. One user mentioned that a popular fried chicken restaurant in Yanji had people waiting for over 2 hours without getting a chance to eat. Another popular restaurant selling skewers had people waiting over an hour just to enter after having called ahead more than an hour before arrival. In Guiyang, famous street food stalls or local specialty eateries typically require a wait time of about an hour. Fourthly, the number of weddings drastically declined, and the wedding banquet market suffered a significant setback. As the last extended holiday of the year's first half, the May Day holiday is typically a golden week for wedding banquets. In previous years, bookings for wedding banquets during this period were hard to secure as early as March, but this year, the period unexpectedly turned into an off-season for weddings. Industry insiders revealed that in May this year, their company hosted 1,166 weddings nationwide, a decline of more than 25% from the same period last year. From May 1st to May 5th alone, there were only 530 weddings, a reduction of more than 28% compared to last year. The marketing director of a hotel in Jinan noted that while in previous years the hotel could host 50 to 60 wedding banquets during the May Day holiday, this year they only hosted 11 to 12, a drop of about 70%. The downturn in the wedding and banquet market is also linked to the downgrading of consumption. Many couples are reducing their wedding budgets, opting for no-frills weddings and other minimalist wedding styles. Hotel staff mentioned that newlyweds are no longer pursuing large banquets, but are instead seeking smaller, more economical wedding formats, with many reducing the number of tables at their receptions from 10 to 20 to just 7 or 8. In addition to the above anomalies, more and more people are opting for trains over planes due to better cost effectiveness, leading to unsold airline tickets. Airlines had no choice but to offer discounts, with prices on popular routes even dropping to just over 300 yuan at times. Before the May Day holiday, a university student posted a question on Weibo: where can a student travel on a budget of 700 yuan? This sparked a lively discussion among netizens. One netizen suggested, "You can walk around a park near your home for free, find a hiking trail nearby that doesn't require an entrance fee, bring enough food and water, and spend the whole day hiking and playing in the water. Keep transportation costs between 300 to 400 yuan." On Chinese social media, many users expressed frustration about budget traveling. They shared that to save money, they are compelled to hunt for the best deals, purchase hard seat tickets, stay in hostels, and seek discounts. Some even resort to sleeping in parks, subways, or hot pot restaurants. This approach not only takes up significant time, but also leaves them mentally, emotionally, and physically drained by the time they arrive at their destination, making it difficult to truly engage with the local culture and scenery. Amid an economic downturn, the robustness of consumer spending will serve as a barometer for whether the Chinese economy will improve. The consumption data from the May Day holiday confirms a harsh reality. The public's willingness and ability to spend are declining, and the main consumer group becoming increasingly frugal. A young Beijinger named Yang told Radio Free Asia that his friends have changed their holiday travel habits post-pandemic, especially in the last 2 years. His friends and classmates have opted for family camping trips during short holidays, which often require no entrance fees and save on accommodation costs. Another popular option is day trips by car, returning home in the evening, which also saves on accommodation and other expenses, referred to by some as special forces travel. The so-called special forces travel involves reducing the travel budget to the minimum, focusing only on free hiking adventures. Yang believes that with the ongoing economic slump and decreasing incomes, there is a corresponding reduction in spending on leisure activities. The reason for young people embracing a frugal consumption model are straightforward. The situation is complex, earning money is not easy, and the future holds great uncertainty. Amid sharp reductions in income and increasing inflationary pressures, including rising utility costs and upcoming fare hikes for high-speed trains in June, with some areas already experiencing increases, personal wages remain stagnant. Additionally, many people have faced pay cuts or are at risk of layoffs. This trend of reduced consumption is likely to persist for a considerable time. For the dining and tourism industries, this scenario could intensify the already fierce competition. A netizen on social media lamented, "It must be said, there is a serious problem with the national economy. I work in the clothing industry, and usually just before Labor Day, Business would boom as many customers buy clothes for vacation. My social media feeds used to be filled with customers going on vacations. But this year, there are far fewer people traveling, and those who do mostly stay nearby. Business has never been as bad as Labor Day this year. It's not just bad, it's dismal. I've been in the women's clothing business for 13 years with about 4,000 real customers in my social circle. Nobody is making money, and nobody wants to spend. Professor Xie Tian in business at the University of South Carolina, Aiken, asserts that the unstable real estate market and sluggish stock market have eroded Chinese consumers' confidence in the economic future, diminishing the effectiveness of holidays as a tool to boost consumption. He argues that the primary issue facing the Chinese economy is this deep-seated lack of consumer confidence and a generally pessimistic economic outlook. Therefore, encouraging people to take time off in an attempt to stimulate consumption is unlikely to be effective. To truly stimulate consumption, strategies must focus on expanding employment and fostering income growth. During the May Day holiday, Hong Kong experienced a surge in tourism. However, unlike in the past when Chinese tourists visiting Hong Kong spent freely, the visitors now are price-sensitive, budget travelers from the mainland, mostly interested in free walking tours. Mainland tourists' spending habits are noticeably shifting towards greater frugality, with even university students visiting Hong Kong attempting to spend only 100 yuan a day. Including visits to the Peak, Yao Tsam Mong, trams, ice cream trucks, and West Kulan Cultural District, choosing to return to Shenzhen overnight to save costs.
Special forces travel in Hong Kong. Today's challenge is to spend only 100 Hong Kong dollars for a full day of activities. The first stop is Goldfish Market, a free underwater world with adorable chubby fishes. Then taking the MTR to the streets of Mong Kok, encountering the famous Mr. Softy at the Yes and Right House for $13, followed by a walk to Star Ferry. On the other side is the Hong Kong Observation Wheel, where you can sit on the railings and dance with the domestic helpers. Dinner was at a nearby small restaurant for lo mein and lemon iced tea. After dinner, I took a tram ride near Central and then the MTR back home. Total expenditure today was 122 Hong Kong dollars, equivalent to 113 yuan. So the challenge failed.
Recently, a mainland university student shared a post on the social media platform Xiaohongshu titled "A University Student's 100 HK Dollar One-Day Tour of Hong Kong," outlining his travel strategy to spend only $100 in Hong Kong. Since it's a 100 HK dollars budget, one must travel frugally. He stated before departure, preparing six essentials for crossing the border, including three bottles of mineral water, a 10,000 megawatt power bank, a mobile data SIM card, a plug adapter, Alipay's travel QR code, and downloaded Google Maps. His itinerary ran from noon until 9 p.m. After preparing these six magic items, the journey began from Lientang Port, with the first popular destination being Mong Kok. After crossing the border, he took the 79K bus to Fanling for $6, approximately a 30-minute ride. He detailed, upon exiting the immigration hall, immediately turn left to the end. The 79K platform isn't in the bus parking bay. Turn left again within 50 meters. There's an underground passage. Follow the signs to the surface to find the 79K platform, known as the cheapest way from Shenzhen to Fanling or Shuangshui. A young cousin duo from Liaoning province, Li and Deng, accepted an interview with foreign media. They chose budget travel in Hong Kong, traveling to the city during the day and staying overnight in Shenzhen. Miss Li stated that for the same price, the accommodations in Shenzhen are better in quality, larger in space, and offer superior service, and it's only an hour's drive to Hong Kong. She mentioned that the trip cost about 500 HK dollars, including transportation, tickets to ride the observation wheel to view Victoria Harbor, and food expenses. To save money, Li, following advice from Xiao Hongshu, brought bottled water from Shenzhen, discovering significant savings as water costs 1 yuan in the mainland, compared to $10 in Hong Kong. After the May Day holiday, the Hong Kong government announced that approximately 766,000 mainland tourists entered Hong Kong, averaging about 153,000 daily entries. This is 22% higher than the same period last year, estimated to have brought over 2 billion Hong Kong dollars in consumer spending to Hong Kong's economy. The average expenditure was 2,611 Hong Kong dollars per person. However, most mainland tourists practiced budget travel. The peak day for mainland tourist entries was May 2nd, with about 192,000 visitors. The most used entry port were West Kowloon Station, mainland port area, followed by the Khao Ma Chau Spor Line Control Point. Dr. Daniel Luang, assistant professor at Hong Kong Polytechnical University, explained that this change in travel patterns and spending habits is mainly due to the economic downturn in China, leading to a more frugal and cautious approach to spending among the public. Hong Kong's retail and dining industries unanimously reported that business during this year's May Day holiday was worse than in previous years. Simon Wong, chairman of the Chamber of Food and Beverage Industry of Hong Kong, stated that the overall earnings from the catering industry from the May Day holiday decreased by 10% compared to usual. Mainland guests' average spending was around 200 Hong Kong dollars, half of what it was before the pandemic, with an estimated 200 million Hong Kong dollars spent on dining, accounting for only about 10% of the total consumption. The tourist behavior of mainland visitors has shifted. Now they mainly visit small shops, benefiting only tea restaurants and fast food outlets, essentially increasing traffic but not profits. However, domestic and outbound traveling spending is witnessing a stark contrast this holiday season. The wealthy are taking advantage of favorable exchange rates to go on shopping sprees abroad. Regarding outbound travel, China's National Immigration Administration stated that during the May Day holiday, there were 8.466 million entries and exits, an increase of 35.1%, with the top five destinations being Singapore, Japan, Thailand, the United States, and South Korea. At the end of April this year, the Japanese yen fell to a 34-year low against the US dollar, making Japan a popular destination for outbound travelers during the May Day holiday. Ms. Chen, who went shopping in Japan during this May Day holiday, told GMN News the malls were packed from the moment they opened. There were long lines at the Louis Vuitton store in Ganza, and brands like Rolex and Chanel required appointments 2 weeks in advance, with many popular items sold out early. During the May Day holiday, hotels in various parts of Japan were fully booked. Ms. Chen mentioned that many people were lining up for hotel check-ins, and on May 3rd, hotel prices had risen to 3 to 4 times the normal rates. Mr. Jiang, a Chinese resident in Japan for over a decade, has also noticed an increase in Chinese tourists recently. According to his observations, places like Nihonbashi, Osaka Castle Park, and Universal Studios Japan were overcrowded. "I avoid these places now. They are too congested. The area I live in used to have few tourists, but now I hear Chinese spoken everywhere." Some tourists are even advising against travel on social media, saying this year global tourists are flocking to Japan. Places like Akihabara, Sensoji, Ganza, and Tsukchi Market are packed with people, and seemingly decent restaurants always has a line of at least 10 meters. Buying Louis Vuitton and Chanel is like buying local specialties. If you're looking for a comfortable travel experience, I advise not choosing Japan during the May Day holiday. According to data from the Japan Tourism Agency, in the first quarter of this year, Chinese tourists were the top spenders in Japan, with total expenditures amounting to 352.6 billion yen, approximately 16.3 billion yuan. The spree of wealthy Chinese in Japan contrasts sharply with the average domestic travel spending in China, which is less than 600 yuan per person. This prompted some nationalists to angrily post criticisms of Chinese tourists spending abroad as worshipping the foreign and shouldn't come back. Assistant Professor Zhu Yuezhong from the Department of Finance at Southern Taiwan University of Science and Technology noted that the contrast between domestic budget travel and international travel statistics underscored the issue of income inequality in China. However, the number of people traveling abroad does not necessarily indicate wealth. While the elite in China still travel internationally, their purchasing power has waned, a fact reflected by this year's substantial decline in revenue within the Swiss luxury watch industry, attributable to decreased spending by Chinese consumers.